Welcome to the 2400 Block Podcast with your hosts, Johnny Rubes and Ken. Podcast spin, intelligence binge watch. Johnny Rubes with the wisdom, never botch. Dark thoughts ventilate, handy great knowledge. 2400 crew, like Griffin College. Clever minds unite, discussions land tight. Sync up thoughts, intertwine, never bark trite. Mics up, lights down, we the crew profound. Johnny Rubes, know the truth, bomb is going round. Catchy beats, the block that never sleeps. 2400 sound in your brain it creeps. Catchy sounds, the block that never bounds. 2400 talks and sucks inside its downs. Catchy beats, the block that never sleeps. 2400 sound in your brain it creeps.
How you doing today?
I'm doing great, and yourself?
I am doing great considering the monumental task I have as a father and being neurodivergent, so I'm good.
Yep. I hear you. It's a challenge to be a parent, no matter what age they are, okay? The parenting never stops. Don't be fooled because the kid has grown and is an adult and all of that shenanigans. Nah, bro. The job and never stop. Yeah.
It's just a growner kid that hasn't quite learned a lesson yet.
Exactly. They still navigate for as long as we do navigate as well. So we can relate on that aspect.
And groaner is not a word. I just have to throw that in there.
they're like, it was good.
We sure have quite the show here tonight. We have Blanca E. Rodriguez. She is our guest. Definitely give her a round of applause here.
The wounded healer. That is an amazing title.
Thank you.
When you talk about healing, I'm actually going to school for becoming a healer. But when you say wounded healer, that has connotations of PTSD, or anything that requires that title before you put the word healing in. So that caught my eye a lot. So much respect alone.
Thank you
for the journey came up with that name. What did that name, what does it mean to you?
Well, wounded healers, we are individuals that we are enabled to help others by the traumatic experiences that we had in life, whether it is the tragic death of a loved one, the being bullied by family members and or at school. And this is just, in general terms, or sexual assault. I went through all of these very big challenges, very deep rabbit holes. By the time I reached 9 years old, and then living in a world of silence, living in a world where you don't talk about the dead, you don't talk about mental illnesses. This was back in the 70s. I am old school like that. My mother is 93 years old, and my father died when he was 43 years old in his place of work, in his jewelry store. His life was taken, and definitely me being the youngest of three siblings, there was a rule of, oh, she's the young one. She doesn't understand. She doesn't know. And that's how my deep, deep wounds started to grow very, very quickly. And then living around chronic untreated mental illnesses, my poor mother, back in those days, here we go again, being in silence, and the stigma of you don't talk about mental illnesses because otherwise your life is basically over. Because it was a one pill fix all kind of thing with mental illnesses back in that day. And this pill will be worse than a horse tranquilizer because the patient will either be a zombie. Oh my God.
Drugs, I love them. They're great.
Yeah, it was worse than horse tranquilizer because the patient will either be a zombie or when they were off the medication, they will become something else. And so it was a very confusing time. Very, very dark seasons of my life, very long-term dark seasons, living in silence, living in shame, living in confusion. And 47 years later, I did a co-authorship and I decided to say it all. And I said it all the more people that I can share my story with, the better. I'm a licensed massage therapist for over 20 years. So yes, I'm in the category of a healer. I am a holistic life coach. I am a speaker, an educator. I'm into fitness instruction for individuals over 45 years old. I've been a professional dancer for over 40 years of my life, and I'm still teaching to this day. So that is a big blessing. That is the harmony that helped me.
Are you trying to date yourself?
Was that?
Are you trying to date yourself? Because you were like 40 years. You know what?
I date myself, and it's really cool.
You were like, you got to be like 35, 25, something like that. I don't.
Well, did you so much. No plastic surgery. No plastic surgery. There's no Botox here.
Lucky for us, John Eric or Johnny Rubes, my boy, been knowing him for a long time. Somehow he's getting away with not getting gray hair here. This is what it is.
Gray is great. Gray is beautiful. I mean, I have gray hair. It's just that you cannot see it, but I have gray hair, definitely. Yeah.
Hey, Ken, I'm going to bring this one up. And I just, messaged her this morning. Is that you and I, of course, Ken, we have the same birthday, September 30th. And Libra. As for her, it's just a few days later after us. Hers is on October 2nd, so she's a Libra, us. Yes.
You're a Libra, too?
Yes.
Uh-huh. No way. Hold on. Let me get my B-boy stance.
Happy Libra birthday people here in the house.
We have birthdays coming up. Heck yeah. Fist bump.
Yep. Absolutely. Happy Libra. birthday to us Libra people. We are fabulous. We are fantastic. We are phenomenal. Oh, yeah. And we rock.
Yes, we do. Right now, I'm like, I know Libras, but we don't get together like this on a national stage and talk to people and with our awesomeness all at once. So this is going to be a really good show.
This is a good triple whammy right here.
Yep. Well, I'm coming in right now after my son. Where are we, Mr. Rubes?
Where are we? Well, as I said to her earlier, before we recorded ourselves, I said to her that I'm from, Aurora, Illinois. It's a suburb in Chicago. And she is right now, you go ahead and say it, Blanca.
Yes, I am right now in Southeast Florida. I live at a small town called Stuart. It's 2 hours south of Orlando, 2 hours north of Miami in the Southeast Coast. And it's 100 million degrees down here. So, yes, absolutely. I am in the deep, deep south. That is for sure. And besides, I'm Puerto Rican, so we're from the tropics here. Yep.
Puerto Rico.
She's used to it.
Oh, yeah. Puerto Rico.
Boricua.
I I'm not Latin. At least I haven't done my genealogy, but my sons have Mexican, so I can rep some Latin going on here. I'm repping Latin. No matter how it works, it's genetic now.
And where are you at, Ken?
I'm in Redlands, California. Redlands is tucked real nicely and away from all the chaos and crazy people. Where if you're familiar with Ontario Mills, which is about probably maybe 80 miles from LA, we're east going towards Palm Springs and all that stuff in California. So it's like Ontario's the hub for all logistics. We're tucked in nice and neatly and it's a nice little quaint little town. I love it here.
Sounds lovely. Sounds attractive, definitely, being away from the craziness of big cities. I am a big fan of staying away from big cities myself.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay. I get it. But I have auditory and sensory processing disorder. So just like Superman, at least Clark Kent anyway, the world's overwhelming. So any silence that I can get on a regular basis.
Yeah. Gotta quiet the noise however you can, because there's a lot of noise out there all the time.
Yes, indeed. And thanks to technology, we're here together.
Yes, I love
that. That's so wonderful.
So happy. This is so awesome.
So do I get to ask all the questions? It's my turn?
Yes.
Is it my turn?
Well, yes, you know what, Ken? I'm going to try to speed
anything you want.
I'm going to try to speed up these questions, though, so I can... So you can get to the nitty gritty later on, Ken, round, you know, when you're round two. So.
Oh yeah. No, you go ahead. I thought you guys did a little rendezvous. So.
Oh no, not yet. We were just waiting for you. Respectfully waiting for you.
Well, I'll
You want to be complete without you anyway, so.
Oh.
Yeah.
You know, what? Just real quick before we go on. This guy really knows how to schmooze me. I am not like moved so much by compliments, but he has a way. I'm like, well, thanks.
Exactly.
But go ahead. Go ahead, brother.
All right. So, I know you already talked a little bit about your humble beginnings growing up over there in Puerto Rico. I'm just going to skip on over to the second question here. How did you get your start in being a massage therapist?
I've always been a helper since I was a little kid. I was raised in a big family, a whole bunch of brothers, sisters. Well, I'm the youngest of three brothers and sisters, but I had a whole bunch of cousins and uncles, aunts, big family. And definitely we were all about the team work. Every single time that there was a little, like what they call the little family gathering, meant like 30 people, but to us, it was a small family gathering. So everybody was helping, everybody was being a helper. And these are things that I am very grateful for, because I took it for the rest of my life, definitely. And I wanted to go to school, I mean, at first for physical therapy, but I am not a college person. Me and college, we just don't connect. We never connected. I never connected to the college studying. Yes, the college party life. That is a whole other ballgame. But going to college to learn, actually, no, I didn't connect with that. And then if there was a moment in my life, because I was a secretary, I was a waitress, I did a travel agent, and it was all about helping and helping and helping. So when I moved to Florida, I wanted to do something new with my life. I wanted to grow and do something different. And at 38 years old, I decided to go back to school for massage therapy. And it was the best decision that I ever done in my life. And this is when age is not a limit to hit that restart button again. I got so much more than I bargained for with my massage therapy career. I started learning about alternative health. I started learning about body, mind, and spirit connection. And in those times, I was in the middle of a disastrous plague with domestic abuse relationship with the father of my kids. So this was like the start of a wake-up call in my life to say, okay, there is something better, there is something bigger for me in my life. And it was definitely so much more than I bargained for, because it really helped me to realize that I can do better. Mm-hmm. I can change. I can really take matters in my hands and change for the better. And this is when being a helper is a beautiful thing, but being a helper can really come back to bite us in the ass, because then we want to be the yes person and help so much and so much and so much that there's no time to help ourselves. And when we come from a background where I have been a background of silence, abuse, sexual abuse, abandonment, neglect, chronic untreated mental illnesses, instability, abandonment, neglect, because there was mental illness involved in the equation at all times, it was very hard for me to get out of that crazy vicious circle that I thought they will never end. And I grew up understanding that, well, you know, being abused, I guess, is normal, because all I received was I was bullied by my family. I was bullied by even my own mother, God bless her soul. And then fast forward all those years of silence and shame, and believing that somehow everything was my responsibility. Everything was my fault until it was time for change. And going to massage therapy school, definitely. definitely it was a big rooting for the changes that I am doing. I mean, all the way to this day, 20 years later of massaging people from all ages, tens of thousands of individuals. The last two places that I've been working for us has been rehab centers for drug addiction and alcohol abuse. I was there years ago. So this was the biggest calling in my massage therapy career, understanding that, wow, I could have easily been a statistic because I went down that rabbit hole. And it doesn't discriminate by age, sexual orientation, financial status. I have worked from the homeless person all the way to the MD, the anesthesiologist, and even the lawyer and the person that works in the Pentagon. So if this
didn't... Mother Teresa over here.
Oh my God, honey. Oh my God, I'm Mother Blanca here, but holy...
Mother Blanca. Yeah, right.
Did I get more than I bargained for with my beautiful career, which is massage therapy, and I have the blessing and the honor to serve all of these people in a very different way because it's different now. Now I take very good care of myself so I can keep on being of service to others. So it's a beautiful journey full of rocks, stones, falling down, getting back up, brushing it off. Let's keep on going. I mean, getting out.
And that's the important part.
Oh, yeah. Yes, absolutely. Up. Absolutely. Yeah. And it really helped me to, you know, really pave the way of where I am now in life. And I am very, very grateful to still be here, still be around, and still be here. I mean, sharing with you.
You're Dr. Dre. Still repping the streets. Still loving police. Yeah. Ew.
Still, man.
Love it. Yeah. I love it.
You've been blessed and then you having to give back, that itself is amazing.
No, yes. It sends chills down my spine because for the way you're mentioning it, it looks easy. The way you're just letting it all off, but we're talking about complex compound trauma here.
Absolutely.
And only a person who has really received healing or gotten to a place to be able to say that, it's an honor to be on the show with you today.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's been it's a journey. It's a long one. It's a deep one. Healing is not about running away from our trauma. Healing really is about confronting the trauma head on, face first. Yes, really going down that rabbit hole of suffering of, yes, I was in my self-destructive pattern. I was going in the pity party. I was being the victim of everybody. And it was time for a change. I had enough of this redundancy. I had enough of this repetitive pattern that was really not taking me where I really wanted to go. And I had two kids with a man that he was self-destructive as well. We were mirroring each other. It wasn't that he was the villain of, he was the horrible, oh, you're the monster and I'm the victim. Yes, I tried to really portray myself in that character. No, the movie really didn't go like that. The real behind the scenes was about we were mirroring each other. He was sexually abused as a child. He never recovered from it. He was a drug addict to the day he died. I was sexually abused as a child. I had issues with drugs myself, but I had an addictive personality all the way to when I took matters into my hands and I said, enough with this. It's enough. I mean, it's time to recover. It's time to go where I was running away from for 47 years of my life through a book, through writing a chapter in a book. And the book asked me, you're going to write your story. I'm like, well, if I'm going to write my story, I'm going to say my truth. And it's time to open up, let it all out, and really try to help others with this, with my story. Try to really help others improve their quality of life, because that restart button is always there no matter what age we are.
And well, you've got to stop. you are making me tear, and like the movie, was it Ringing Over Spaghetti? Whatever. Get back in there, tear. because everything you're seeing right now is my story, and I'm like trying my best, like to go, wait a minute. Right. Wow. It's a beautiful thing to be able to hear. I'm sorry. It's a beautiful thing to be able to not be in a therapy group hearing this, but to be on a podcast hearing it fluid, every detail, and with courage. And when you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, right.
That was basically it. And this is what happened. One of those aha big ass wake up calls for me was when I gave birth, when I become a mother, when it was not only about me, my pity party, feel far sorry for me, I'm everybody's victim. It was not about me anymore. It was this like this. I really didn't give life to my kids. My kids gave me a new opportunity on living a better life because it stopped being about me and my issues. It was about, okay, I gotta put my cojones in my place and start growing the F up if I want to help my kids break that generational cycle of abuse, because this is not only limited to me. It's limited, it goes all the way to my mother's generation. It goes to other generations as well.
But breaking generational trauma.
Oh my God. I broke the generational trauma from the biggest of the rooting of my soul. I said, I'm going to break this generational trauma because otherwise I'm going to end up in a relationship with my fully grown kids like my mother. We had a lot of animosity. We were clashing. We were at war all the time. There was years that I didn't speak a word to my mother. And yes, we came back later on in life and we forgave each other. But my poor mother, my mother was very physically active, but she never took care of her mental state. My mother is 93 years old right now and advanced stages of dementia. So what do I do? Am I going to hold another grudge or am I going to forgive? Be empathetic. Really mean what I say when let's improve quality of life. That has to start with me, to the deepest of the deepest of my soul. I just came back from Puerto Rico last month, and I never could imagine that I would see the day when I will be changing my mother's diaper. And when that happens, it's one of the biggest wake-up calls of my life because it's like,
oh, hell no, I got to change the diaper.
The last time I cleaned a butt was my kids, and my daughter's 23 years old. It's like, holy smoke, that's a big damn diaper. But anyway, besides that.
Oh, God, that's big. Why are we doing this? Why?
But besides that, definitely having that empathy, compassion and kindness and understanding is, and I looked at her that she really can't talk much. And I see her on the hospital bed in the house and I say, wow, what could have been, how our relationship could have been and is not. And with my mother, I learn a lot of how to be as a mother that I am myself. And when I'm telling you that it's like a whole turnaround, and it's like, well, I didn't have a good relationship with my mother. She definitely has no clue about many things of who I am, but I definitely have this strong ass bond with my kids that they are adults. They are under no obligation to even want to talk to me. And who do they go to for anything that they need?
Mama,
It's like, mama.
Me.
Okay, bring it. I'm here. So yeah, you know, these are the things that we live and learn, definitely. And life is about progress, not perfection. I never said I am perfect. In this human experience, there's no such thing as perfection. That is a fantasy. That is not true, because we were not born to be perfect. And these are when it's good to recognize our mess ups, but then it's good to recognize growth. that I am not going to stay redundant in that circle of messing it up over and over because I did it enough for a lifetime. So how am I not going to step forward, step into my power and say it all out? And what better platforms, that podcasting, that being with you here, right here, right now, saying
on the block.
I am positively sure that I am not the only person that has been through this in life. Come on. We are all, I mean, I'm sure that there's a lot of people that they definitely say it's like, well, there's some similarities here. And whoa, it's like this can be a wake up call for someone. And when it's a wake up call for someone, something that I say, you guys say to the listeners, to the viewers that can help them in some way or form. I know in my heart that us three, we are like, we conquered, we succeeded, yes. We seized the day. Yeah, we rock.
Yeah. And that power alone, just someone watching you come out of your shell and be sick and tired, being sick and tired, is the reason why we all do this podcasting and telling our story. So, yeah, in the Latin culture is chingona, correct?
Chingona.
Chingona. You are
a chingona.
A warrior queen at this point.
Thank you.
And for the understanding impaired, Quejones is man marbles, okay?
Yes.
She took her man marbles and she got it together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Her woman marbles.
Yes.
All right, I see you've moved on. I mean, not really moving on, but you added this into your massage therapy, but you are also a canine massage therapist. How did that come about?
Oh, yes. Canine massage therapy. Canine massage therapy is like really not known at all here in the U.S., but this skill has been around since 2700 B.C., actually. It dates from thousands of years.
Wow.
Massage therapy for humans have been around since 3000 B.C. And this is the thing. Us and dogs, we're mammals. We have muscle mass, organs, chemicals.
This is true.
Nerves, I mean, yes, we are mammals. And just like us with massage therapy, oh my God, I have a spasm. Oh my God, I have a migraine. Oh my God, what happened to my lower back? I've been sitting for a long time. I need a massage. Well, the dog, no, he hasn't been sitting for a long time, but there is massage therapy for everybody. And this is the thing, one of the most well-known stories about canine massage therapy, Julius Caesar. Julius Caesar had epilepsy. And for him to control his epilepsy symptoms, he would take his massage therapist to war with him. Smart man. I mean, for real. Okay.
Wow.
You're in war. You're stressed out. Bring my massage therapist here. I need a massage. So they're here. Yeah. Smart man. Smart guy. And then his very smart massage therapist used to massage his very ferocious war dogs. In the Roman Empire, animal massage therapy was performed for high-end people, for their horses, for their dogs, for their animals. And then all the way to the Americas here in the U.S. It started in the 1970s with equine massage and very soon after canine massage therapy. Yes.
You say the 1970s is when massage came into our picture?
Yeah. And then
us regular folks got massages in the...
any kind of animal massage therapy came to the U.S. in the 1970s. So this is pretty recent. Yes.
Wow.
It's pretty recent and it's pretty unknown. But this is the thing. The American Kennel Club, AKC, approved of the practices of massage therapy for dogs from all the way from puppies all the way to their elderly years when they're crossing a rainbow for improving the quality of life of the animal. It is proven. I have many doggy clients, and let me tell you something, okay? It's the best. Oh my God. It's my favorite thing to do as a massage therapist is to massage dogs because they are honest. They don't have to say a word to say it all. Okay.
And they're probably the easiest customers too.
Oh, well, they are phenomenal. And this is the most interesting part. they don't turn. I don't have to say anything because they'll turn on the other side. And then when they're done, they just get up and walk away. Oh,
as give me a treat. As if it says beware of dog for a reason.
Exactly.
I do work. I'm barking. I'm doing my thing. I'm going to need a massage at the end of the week, please.
Yes. Yes, I have.
Thank
you. My favorite clients are dogs. I'm not going to sugarcoat it here.
And my son, because we have a massage gun that we got because, we have all kinds of reasons why we need massages. But
yes,
recently we were taking the gun and my son's like, yeah, I just need it up here. I was like, you're 6 years old. But I was realizing he plays all day.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course his muscles are.
Yes, absolutely.
And that would be a good reason for him to calm because, you know, I do meditation, but I was thinking,
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
If you have a massage gun and your son, your 6-year-old son is telling you, oh, I can use that over here. Oh my God, that is so amazing and phenomenal. Congratulations to your amazing son for being so smart and so open to, hey, I am hurting. I can have a massage anytime. I have worked on kids that are 6-7 years old because, and they have had spasms, very bad spasms because of their soccer players or whatever the case, and is highly effective on them. It's just that the time frame for kid massage therapy is really reduced. It's 10-15 minutes and the kid is done because they're so busy. It's too much over that. So yes, children massage therapy is highly recommended, especially with kids that are doing sports.
Sports.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm glad it's happening because it has been helping the calming process. So,
oh, that's great.
Not to compare him to a dog because I know this is about to canine massage. My son has canine-like qualities.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. Our dogs are fabulous. They're the best thing that ever happened to us humans. I mean, I have kids, but I love the dog. Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Now, which are the best customers? The big dogs, the mid-sized dog, or the real small dogs?
He's getting into the dog size. The big ones, do they? Or
When it comes to size, I love any size. I love to work on any size of dog, but definitely the most intelligent dogs that I have ever worked on are Labrador Retrievers, Golden Retrievers, German Shepherds, and Dobermans. Those are powerhouses of animals to work with because once you give them only one service and they know exactly what's coming to them every time I go through that door. They're like, yep, treats and massage. Here we go. Bring it on.
They know what to expect.
Oh, yeah. They know what's coming. Treats and massage. And they're in that order. Always.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
On average, how long is that? Is that just a few minutes with the dog?
Well, with the dog, definitely is up to them.
Oh, okay.
They are the ones who know the timing. But I have had dogs that I've been with them 15 minutes. I have dog that I've been with them a full hour, and they want more. Yes, sir.
Mm.
Yeah.
Is it the size thing or is it a?
Oh
a
no!
Dog,
it's just
a
that
small
they just,
dog mentality.
Oh yeah! It's just that they love it so much and so much and so much that it's like keep on doing, keep on going, and keep on going, and don't leave. Mm-hmm. Definitely, I love that.
Yeah, like you see me doing this. I'm going to keep on.
Absolutely. Exactly. Love it. Love it.
Now, you're a dog owner, though, right? You have a dog right now in the house?
Well, our beloved dog passed away 2 years ago.
Oh.
Yes. And I
Rest
live in
an
apartment. Yes, yes, definitely. She is really, really an angel, this beautiful dog. And we live in a place that is too small for having any dog. And with my level of work, it will be a disservice to the animal to have a dog at right now in our house. So I am definitely not thinking about having a dog because what I am doing with my business is really taking all of my time. And I truly believe that if you're going to have a dog at home, you got to have time for your dog.
Yep.
Because dogs are not pets. Dogs are not a toy that you just entertain yourself with and go away. Dogs are family and they have all the rights to be treated as such. And if you're going to if you cannot take care of your dog, do a service to your dog and let go of the dog. Or plain and simple, don't have a dog. Okay. Yep. It's a big responsibility. It's 7 days a week and there's no days off and there's no vacation time from the dog unless you take him to a boarding place and they are safe and secure in a great environment. But otherwise, do yourself a favor. If you're working all day out and you have a dog and the dog is crying all day long and barking all day long and the dog destroys your house because it's not because of being vicious, it's because they are lonely. Yes. Okay, so yes. And please be aware of the breed of the dog. If you're going to get a dog, and thank you for letting me talk about this a little bit more. If you are gonna, I mean, if you think a breed of a dog is so cute, for example, huskies, Siberian huskies, it's a beautiful animal, it's a working animal. And when the dog is home alone and bored, the dog is gonna go to work and the dog will destroy your house, okay? Because they're working animals. On the other hand, well, yeah, man. Oh,
I'm not plowing snow, but we don't go to work in this house.
Yeah, I'm not plowing snow. I'm going to go to work in some other way or form. So I'll destroy your doors. I'll destroy your shoes.
I'm going to work.
Bed. Oh yeah, I'm going to bed and to work. And they really are working dogs. Besides, they shed all year.
I actually like that perspective. You actually translated something that makes sense when it comes to like dog behavior.
Mm-hmm.
They don't come into this world going, yeah, I want to be at your house chilling, watching whatever. Exactly. I was bred to do this. I'm not doing that. So I'm going to do that in your house.
Exactly.
But you're not going to know what that is. So you're right.
Absolutely.
You're bred to do certain things.
It's vital that you learn and get informed about the breed of the dog and make a decision. Okay. And there are shelters with every single breed that you can imagine that are willing to, if you're willing to adopt, please, please contact adoption centers for any breed of dogs, because there's over 450 breeds of dogs. There's always over 450 shelters for these breeds specifically that offer adoption. And of course, because of people that, whatever the case may be, death in the family, abandonment, they were deployed, sickness, whatever the case may be, or simply that they don't want to deal with the dog. They don't have what it takes to deal with the dog. Just check it out and make your research before you get a dog. Do yourself a favor and do the dog a favor as well.
And just to really throw in there, and this, you know, dogs, in my mind, they're people. I mean, I was never knowing I was going to be a real dog person to my best friend's dog, but treating them as you would treat yourself, kindly, humanely, because they're close to the human process as possible.
Mm-hmm.
It is very important that you say this and give information to where, you know, if you can provide it, we'll put it in the description below so people can have that fear and not do the wrong thing because they didn't have the resources right available. So if you could throw it out there, if you know of anything that's national, that would, you know, that can help people do the right thing when it comes to a living thing that is giving you the emotional support, even though it's not an emotional support animal. Mm-hmm. It's giving you the emotional support.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And most of these animals, I mean, our last dog, she was a mutt. She, I mean, I don't know what breed she was. She was a breed of something or many breeds together. I don't know. But mm-hmm. she was an emotional support dog, because this is the thing, how strong a bond between a dog and human can be. Our dogs are our mirrors. So if you want to know something, I promise you this, this is not, you know, a fantasy. This is a fact. This is proven by vets, scientists, and everything, that the bond between the dog and human can be so strong and so strong and so strong that the dog will adopt the personality of their human companion. So I am not kidding you when I say to you, if you have a dog, your dog is your mirror. So if you want to know someone, check the behavior of the dog.
Wow.
And you will know much more about this.
Dog, Never
yes.
mind.
Yes.
Dog's gonna tell on me. This car's angry. See me?
Yeah, and the dog is angry too. Absolutely. Oh, you check it out. This is the total absolute truth. So when I visit people for the first time, I always make sure that I have interaction with the human and the dog when they are in the same room, just to check where is this going. If the owner of the dog is like, hey, Sparky, stop it. He's like, ah, the dog is just like the dog is just like their owner. Forget it. And yes, absolutely.
This is why I'm peeing all over the carpet. You scare me. Damn it. Stop. This is stressful. I was giving you emotional support. You yeah. making me emotional.
Yeah, it's yeah. Like, and when the human companion is a laid back, calm person, the dog is simply amazing. It's like my husband. He's a very calm person. He had a beautiful collie, beautiful Kelly. Oh my gosh, she was a supermodel and she was regal. And then she would just sit down and say, like, well, whenever you're ready, come on over and pet me. That was her demeanor. Yes, when I, like that, just like that. And it was that was the
I'm
message.
Summoning you for a petting.
Second. I have something for you to admire, and it's me, of course. That was the demeanor of the dog. Yes, yes. It's
oh,
incredible. It's a pretty.
This is the dog podcast, by the way, on the 2400 Block Podcast.
Speaking of dogs, I actually met a Siberian Husky during a Labor Day weekend, and this is the morning when I just woke up.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
My yeah. God with you.
Oh, wow.
What a beauty.
How do you deny whatever he's asking for? How do you deny anything?
How are you going to say go away to that?
He doesn't even have to ask a question. You just give him everything. Just, okay.
Whatever you want. You want a treat? You want a slice of my pizza? Go ahead. Have it.
This same dog was actually licking my girlfriend while she was still asleep.
Oh my God, I love
adopting the behavior of the licking her and wanting to go to sleep too.
Love it. Beautiful, beautiful. Thanks for sharing.
Oh, you're welcome. And I have actually one more. That's actually just one out of the two. Let me show you the next one.
He brought some canine companions to the podcast. Oh, I didn't know we were doing a canine podcast today.
Oh, this is awesome.
There
oh,
is.
Look at that.
Oh.
So cute. Yeah. Oh, my God. Beautiful.
That's the other one.
Beautiful, beautiful.
My biggest question about huskies is if they have hair that's meant for negative 50 degrees or whatever, how are they able to survive? I know it's an adapting thing, but how do you survive environments that are not like that?
It's very sad to say that dogs adapt to their environment no matter what, even if they are in pain and suffering throughout their lives. I have seen so many Siberian Huskies in the tropics in Puerto Rico, and and then this is the worst part. People get tired of them because they shed too much because of whatever the reason may be, and they are abandoned. On the other hand, my stepson has a Siberian Husky. He's a retired military. We had the dog with us for a year while he was deployed. And the dog, this was the life of the dog. The dog will go to daycare. Okay, that was part of the budget for the dog. Go to daycare all day long. He was brushed, he was bathed and everything. And still, my house was full of fur. It was full of, he was shed and shed and shed and shed. And we will have the AC for the dog down at 70 degrees because it's the environment that where the dog is safest the most, where the dog is having more quality of life. But when there is, this tropics and people not having these dogs in a healthy environment for good quality of life, they live a life of suffering, pain, overheating. When Hurricane Maria destroyed Puerto Rico back in 2017, I had a friend, she had a St. Bernard in Puerto Rico. She had to move her life to New York because of the dog, because the dog will die of heat stroke if she didn't move, if she didn't get out, because there was no power, there was no water, there was no resources for the dog. And she said, well, I made my decision. I have to leave. And that she did. And it was for the dog. And then when everything came back to so-called normal, more normalcy in Puerto Rico, like 2 years later, then she went back to Puerto Rico. But her main reason to leave was the dog. And that's a selfless act of unconditional love for a dog that is not a dog, that is her family. And that's a beautiful thing.
No, that is selfless. Nice. Come on. For the dog, that's, we go, I'm a spend how much? No, yeah, problem.
Exactly.
Oh, no problem. Yeah, I spent $3,000 on my miniature long-haired dachshund passed, but I didn't think about $3,000. I thought about his life.
Absolutely.
I thought about our memories. I thought about his quality of life. I thought about, he's blind and all he wants to do is be able to see to go to the potty, or, hey, I got to take him out there. Yeah. But quality of life, even if it's the end, at 16 years as a, miniature long-haired dachshund, who cares about $3,000? Who cares?
So true. Absolutely.
All right. I'm going to switch on to a different topic here. Now, Blanca, can you tell me a little bit more about Toastmasters? Because this is the first time I've heard of them. And what do they do exactly? And how did you got into it?
Toastmasters is a platform that helps individuals improving their abilities to speaking and communicating more efficiently, learning how to be a better speaker. And Toastmasters was actually established in California in 1924. It's been around for 100 years already. They Toastmasters just turned 100 years old. And that's another place where I got much more than I bargained for. I went in because I wanted to be a better communicator about my co-authorship. The publishing company where I did my book, they said, if you want to deliver a compelling story and that people are attracted to what you do, to your authorship, you have to talk to as many people as possible about your book. I said to myself, well, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to go all the way and I'm going to learn how to speak more efficiently, more fluently, more flawlessly. And this is when a teacher of mine, he said, no, you need to go to Toastmasters. Toastmasters is a platform, is a nonprofit. They're not for profit at all. I pay $87 every 6 months to learn how to be better at everything that I'm doing at life, because it's not only learning how to be a speaker, but
that's what Toastmasters do. I'm in.
To everybody, there is a club everywhere. All you need to do is go to toastmasters.org and click where your zip code is from, and you will find a club immediately. And it was created in California by John C. Smedley. And
shout out
Cali. Yeah, absolutely. There is 14,000 clubs all over the planet, 145 countries later, 365,000 members later. It's been here for that long because it's really, really effective. And their logo is Toastmasters, where leaders are made. And I have become much more of a leader because of Toastmasters, because of applying, getting out of that comfort zone of, well, maybe I'll do better later, or maybe I'll just start saying, and be, suck at being a communicator, or am I going to deliver a good message to the masses, to the listeners, to the viewers about improving quality of life, no matter what age we are? And Toastmasters has been pivotal in this career of mine. That is where I am heading to from now on. I want to let go of my very physical job from a massage therapist to be speaking about massage therapy, speaking about canine massage, speaking about mental health, mental illnesses, childhood trauma, speaking about my co-authorship. And that is when Toastmasters has been, oh my God, one of the biggest joys of my life. I've been in Toastmasters only 2 years, but I have met people that they've been there for 38 years. They've been Toastmaster because you're learning and learning and learning and learning, and every single meeting is a different journey. It's a different learning experience. Wow. Why not feed your brain with all of this great information that you can pick from anybody that is there? Because we all go in with this fear. It's like, oh my God, what am I going to do? I'm going to go to the back of the room because I don't want nobody to see me, until they help you get out of that comfort zone and do something better with your life. Like learning, feeding our brain with great health, and health is wealth, because without health.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
It sounds like Toastmasters is the nitrous oxide of self-help. You want to help yourself?
I love it.
Let's go to Toastmasters, level it up here.
Yes.
We don't just want regular self-help.
You want to level it up as a speaker, as a communicator, as a podcaster?
Level it up with Toastmasters.
You know, I have been in my man cave for far too long, and it's only today years old that I just found out about Toastmasters.
I heard of Toastmasters, but like, I thought it was people that were really good at toasting bread. I was like, wow, that sounds like a really good club. Must be like different, like brioche, you know, focaccia bread. Like, you know, it must be really good.
Oh my God, Ken. You know that at first I thought that Toastmasters is like, well, there, the toast is somewhere in the equation. And it's like the toast is somewhere in the equation. But
We're a race car club. We don't do toast
exactly.
at all.
And there's people that they join Toastmasters because there is a wedding that they're going to be the best man, and they're going to deliver a speech saying congratulations. Wow. And they're so scared of messing it up that they joined Toastmasters to learn how to make a toast for a wedding. And I'm like, well, I think that makes kind of
that's some great logic for
there's logic here finally about the toast thing. Yeah.
I thought it was,
you know what, the funny thing about public speeches, I took it when I was in community college, but I have ADHD and autism and a bunch of D's. I can't help but talk. And because I have so much that I'm thinking about, talking just happens. Mm-hmm. And the nerves of it just kind of happen after I get it out. So I need Toastmasters so I can be the most amazing father. So I got to speak to my son effectively.
will love it. You will love it because it helps you this is the best part, that it helps you in your personal life as well. These are things, these are tools that are handed over to you. Learn them. But besides being a Toastmaster, besides your professional life, that it helps you tremendously as well. It's taken to a whole other level that you apply it to your personal life. You apply it to your family. You apply it to be a better communicator with my kids. I didn't know that 2 years ago, but I'm like, okay, I'll celebrate it any day, and I'll do it.
No.
I mean, definitely I love Toastmasters. I began as a member, and now I'm a area director. I take care of 5 different clubs at the moment. Oh, wow. I'm a vice president of education for my core club. So it's like, okay,
man.
I never
we
thought
need
that
autographs
I
was after this.
Nothing. Okay.
What's it called? The reaching your greatest potential. We're literally looking at reaching your greatest potential in motion right now.
Thank you.
Amazing. You are really taking the human, I call it, it's the human race, but while we're racing, it's now about humans being civil and evolving. You are taking so much of what we've had as a life, or we learning everything naturally. This is passed on from generation to generation. Mm-hmm. And you are taking and going, I'm going to make some basic instructions for being myself. And it clearly all this stuff, generational passing down, hasn't worked. So you are a champion of reaching your greatest potential. So that's awesome.
Thank you. That means a lot. Thank you.
No, it's very clear. I'm not a person that schmoozes. If I'm seeing something, I'm calling it for what it is. I'm autistic, so I'm telling the truth.
Thanks so much.
All right,
you.
Ken, I'm going to end this right here on my end so you can do yours. My last question. Here we go.
Brought to you by Blanca E. Rodriguez, the wound healer. We'll help you out, Johnny Rubes.
Okay. So she's an author. And what's the title of your book? And give us some details on what readers can expect out of that. And where can someone get a copy of it?
Oh, absolutely. My co-authorship is called Impact Leadership with Blanca Rodriguez. Excuse me. I am available in Amazon Kindle and paperback. And this co-authorship is very, very meaningful to me because it's the stories of me, myself, and 29 other co-authors from all over the world, from all walks of life. And we share similar stories about falling down, going down the rabbit hole, failing over and over again, feeling like our life is not really going anywhere, and making changes and making it through the other side. It was very interesting how I got this co-authorship. I got a random email in 2021 in the middle of the pandemic, and it said as follows: do you have a compelling story that you could share with others? Do you think you can make an impact as you tell your story? Maybe you can be chosen for a book co-authorship. Give us a call, a 30-minute call. You may be select. You may be the next co-author. And I thought to myself quite a few times in my life, wow, I have been through so much crap in my life and so much ups and downs, this roller coaster ride of really wild stuff in my life that I could really write a book about it. So anyway, it was 30 minutes of interviewing, 45 minutes. I was crying. The interviewer was crying. I was chosen. And this
Did we
is
say crying. Why are we?
Yeah,
crying?
We were crying together because I was telling the story. And it was like, this was a pivotal moment because I was opening up to a total stranger like I never did before in my life. And it was so profound that this interviewer was crying. He was crying, this gentleman, his name is Steve. And Steve was crying, I was crying, and he said, you're chosen, you're chosen. And I was like, wow, this is so interesting. What the hell am I going to do now that I'm going to start writing and everybody's going to know? And it was this imposter syndrome that came right after. And I was like, oh my God, what am I going to do? I did it, and it's
one of the best
decisions I ever done in my life. And here we go again. Little did I know how transformational this co-authorship will be in my life, just like Toastmasters, just like being a massage therapist, just like being a canine massage therapist, a holistic life coach, and taking all of these tools and helping others, helping myself. And really, really, if I have improved this much, if I keep on evolving, not dissolving, so can anybody else. I'm not going to sugarcoat this. If you don't do the work, you're going to stay stagnant. And it's like water. When water is running, water is healthy. When water is stagnant and is stale, what happens? It stinks. It's dying. Ooh. Yes, it's nice. And what are you going to do about it? Are you going to keep on stinking like I did, or are you going to go with the flow?
With that Puerto Rican spice, you feel me? she gave it to you all Latin right now. Oh my God, that's is very true. And
before you pass,
you made me cry, so it does work.
Before I pass the baton, Ken, I'm going to put in a quote that she has said on a past podcast: don't let your past define you.
That is a real, real statement right there, because we all are making decisions based on yesterday. For what?
Yeah.
For what?
Yesterday. And it's
hard because that's the barometer we have, is that's how we get our patterns, by something that happened a minute ago, or even if it's a minute ago, it's still the past. So being present is a very difficult thing. Hence the reason why we're in an age of enlightenment and people going and getting, doing meditation, alternative medicines, because it's hard to be present in a world where you're being inundated with things that you don't get a chance to understand, nor are you being understood. So it's actually understandable.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So true. I can share with you about meditation of how transformative has been in my life as well. I am going to be 59 years old very soon. And menopause is menopause. And menopause has been demonized for a very, very long time. And menopause is a normal process that every woman in this world will pass. I mean, this is something that is normal. It's part of who we are in this human experience. And the first thing that went out the window was my very good sleep. Meditation transformed that. Meditation gets me to sleep. Meditation takes me to a calm place. And in the world that we are right now,
Namaste.
Everything is go, 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 go. Calm is a super power. And to me, my state of calm, it doesn't happen all the time. I'm not all day in a Zen mode, but yeah, because that's
yoga brain.
Exactly. I do yoga, I do meditation, I do prayer, I exercise gratitude every single morning, every single night. But how you wake up is the same as how you go to sleep. How you do anything in life is how you do everything in life. And that's why creating this habit of meditation, prayer, looking for that calm space is so imperative. Here we go again, to build better quality of life. So go ahead and meditate, do guided meditation. I don't sit down and do silence because, then the squirrels will be all over the place and I get distracted. So that's why I do guided meditation. I have a voice guiding me through it all, because otherwise I will be, I gotta do this, because that is how this mind is working. Yeah.
Wait a minute, are we cousins? Because you know what's crazy is, before I get into my questions, that when I started my meditation, I started transcendental meditation. Mm-hmm. And transcendental meditation, not to get onto it for the sake of time, is a quiet one. It's not guided. You have a mantra, and even that's quiet. I don't know why I chose that one, having ADHD, but I'm a person who challenges myself. And when I heard about meditation to help me with my brain and all the circus that's going on up there, I said, I just picked it, I guess, because school, that's the one that school had. But it's taken 3 years for that stillness to take place with that meditation. So me choosing that created a level of discipline. And the reason why I did is because you mentioned sleep. Mm-hmm. When I went there, and it's not a guru, it's the meditation teachers, thousands of years and thousands of years of Vedic tradition. Mm-hmm. He got the shrine, he's teaching me these things, and I'm telling them, hey, I know you guys have been teaching this for thousands of years, but I have a little bit of a problem than most. I can't get none of that to chill. But 3 years, when I first, at least when we did the meditation, I was able to go to sleep and not have to take trazodone. And trazodone is a medication I take for sleep.
Wow.
And when I didn't have to take trazodone to go to sleep, I was like, okay, I can do this.
Yeah.
I struggled for 3 years. But because of that moment, I had a barometer for what could possibly be. And at this moment, I can now slip into my meditative state a lot easier. But the guided meditation was the hardest because I have auditory processing disorder. So if the person's talking and my brain is having its dialogue, I would just be sitting up there going, man, I was going to get into this meditative state, but you keep talking. But they're like, this is a guided meditation. But anyways, you're right. Meditation, I can't even stress it enough. And breath work is the most foundational thing you can do to be a human. And it's the last thing we even talk about.
Oh, my God. Yes. So.
But what I want to get into, and I'm going to streamline mine. Look at me as an ADHD person. So I'm going to streamline. We're going to talk about your practice and the modalities of it. But I mentioned ADHD and autism for a reason. One of my biggest advocacies and missions in life is being a person that thinks differently and still be able to operate, but not looked at as a person who's got it. Like you mentioned, your kids are older, but they still have those same qualities. How does your holistic healing approach work with brains that will forget to be consistent with, I know you have a 45 plus fitness, you have the dog, you have the life coaching. Mm-hmm. How does a person with ADHD and autism and, you know, be borderline personality, how do the people with the mental health issues fit into this mold of all walks of life? Because those are different brains trying to do the same thing.
Yes, absolutely. That is a great question. And this is the most important part of all this process. One size does not fit all. This is on a person-to-person basis. It's a very individual approach to life coaching. My nephew, he's 34 years old and he's nonverbal autistic, okay? He's a very severe case of autism. My sister is ADHD with borderline disorder as well, and I am coaching her. And some days are better than others. There's the ups, there's the downs. But me as a holistic life coach, if I am going to support her journey into something better for herself, I cannot give her a certain time frame because it will be too much for her to handle. It will be too much of a pressure for her. And the life coaching will be good for nothing because it's too much pressure for her. And that is a very important aspect for all life coaches to take under consideration. And this is why I highly recommend to all life coaches to dig deeper on what the goals are, where
Thank
they
you.
Come from. Yes,
Thank
absolutely.
Thank
absolutely.
You. Thank
this
you.
Is, this is not a universal. This is not a one thing like
no,
with
it's
mental
not a cookie
illnesses.
Sheet. Yeah,
this is not like with mental illnesses back in the day that one pill will fix everybody because that never happened. Same thing with holistic life coaching. You are treating a person as a whole, body, mind, spirit, okay? Because what you have in here will definitely translate into the physical world. It's unavoidable. There's no other way to paint it. This is the way it is, period. And you cannot help a person that has no ADHD, that has no challenges, that has no childhood trauma, which is to the minimum for what I'm noticing more and more. A person that had childhood trauma, a person that has ADHD, their brain is developed in a very different way from a person that has a loving mom and dad and everything is beautiful and
everything is awesome
and things is Lego good beans. And it's so good and
right.
The brain development of somebody the brain development of a person with childhood trauma like myself, since I was a little kid, my brain was developed differently. There's no other way to put it. My sister is ADHD and borderline personality disorder. Her brain was developed in a very different way as well. And she is to be treated as such, be respected as such. In the normal world, in the beautiful, perfect world, to create a new habit is 21 to 67 days to create a new habit. Whatever that
you say 61, I thought it was 21.
21 to 67 days.
Wow.
And anything in between.
Upgrade.
But with a lot of other people, like my beloved sister, it has taken her a year to develop a new habit and to do it in a consistent basis over and over and over. And this is when patience is key. This is when supporting and being respectful and understanding that everybody is different is really, really key, because a lot of life coaches, they want to fix your life in 3 months, give me the money, I'm out of here, and next. And no, it's just not the way it works here. I have a life coach, and I've been with the same life coach for 3 years of my life, and it has taken me 3 years of my life to achieve many of the goals that I started putting the idea together 3 years.
These number threes is important. It took me, again, because of my neurodivergence. Mm-hmm. I knew it was going to take me a while, and I fought like hell. Consistency is like, I realize I'm just consistently inconsistent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you're right. Time And if you go to school and we're going to the students with disabilities department at college, we're going to get the more time because the processing of the information is different. Everything is information it all happens through your sensories, eyes, mouth. But if you're not able to get it and you're not getting in the time frame that the cookie sheet's getting it, then we get ousted and labeled all these labels. But the reality is you're brilliant in your own right, depending on how your perspective is perceiving information. With that said, how important is it to incorporate? Because a lot of nutritionists, fitness instructors, all the aspects of doing something healthy, but the mind consciousness is the first thing that happens before we are in a physical presence, whether it be an idea. How do you incorporate mental health as the foundation for all the work you do in your modalities?
Definitely. Brain health is the most important health that we can have for our bodies. And this is the reason. The way that your brain works, that's the way your body works. If there's no other way to put it, if you have a healthy brain, you will have a healthy body.
Okay. Well.
And if you build, if you build consistency, your brain will respond better to consistency. And do you know this? I didn't know this. I learned this in Toastmasters. When you hear things in order of threes, your brain processes better than in order of twos, in order that of fours.
Really?
Three times.
Wow.
Three times in order of threes. Imagine that. So it took you 3 years. It took me 3 years. Imagine that. Here you go with the number three again. It took me 3 years to finally really embrace the changes and all these new habits that I've been really working on really, really hard. So it takes time, and the brain is the one, this beautiful 3 pounds of meat that are inside of our skull. Neuroscientists are still figuring out how our brains are really working. When it comes to consciousness, I was watching this beautiful masterclass about brain health. Imagine that. And the wonders of our brain, how the amygdala is working, how the frontal lobe, the temporal lobe. I mean, wow, how this 3 pound of meat sends all of these signals. So I am doing this movement right now. And this is not my hand. This is my brain sending the signal.
Now you're talking about epigenetics.
Ooh. Oh my God, yes. And then
now you're talking about nerd talk. This is my department.
I'm geeking out big time here.
I'm geeking out. This is my realm. I'm trying my best to not see a geeky thing.
I love it. So the connection between this is the thing. The brain and the gut have an undeniable connection because there are neurochemicals that are created in the gut that goes straight to the brain for a better function, like the happy chemicals in our bodies, dopamine, oxytocin, serotonin, and endorphins, okay? Some of these chemicals, they are created in the gut. So when we eat crappy food, the creation of these neurochemicals, they get compromised. Let's put it that way.
Oh, wow.
Versus eating a healthier diet, then these chemicals will get happier because our gut is happier and the brain-gut combination, that bond is indestructible. So these two are working in unison for better function of our bodies. But at the end of the day, the one that says the last word is that 3 pound of meat that we have inside
of
our
gray matter. Yeah.
The gray matter that is called our brains and of course our central nervous system that starts in the brain and goes all the way down to our spines with these beautiful branches of nerves. It's like a tree. And our central nervous system, you can put one beside the other and you say, holy smokes. There is a similarity and it's really noticeable, okay? A tree, it starts with the rooting and it branches out. Our central nervous system starts in the brain and in the spine and branches out.
The electrical system of your body, people. This is everything that's happening and signals that are coming up are going through that spine and sending signals to your body. Exactly. And if your body gets used to a negative frequency of energy, your body, this is when epigenetics happens, it just gets used to it. Your brain doesn't have to do work anymore. Mm-hmm. It's already happening. So now we're just talking about the signals not coming from the brain anymore because it's now being efficient. And it's like the central nervous system is the fight or fight. So how we breathe is important in how we are able to have homeostasis. So it's absolutely very important.
Beautiful.
Mentioned dose. I was going to ask that question, but you got into it. How I know it's you know, this is going to sound very dark, but happiness is a foreigner to me.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
How is it that one can incorporate something and small doses every day to have that dopamine, oxytocin, serotonin, endorphins, not rush, kind of like the way people would think, oh, I'm going to take drugs or I'm going to drink or I'm going to do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What things can a person do at home just very simply to combat negative frequency by having that rush?
Mm-hmm. Definitely. The one of the really great helpers here for all of these good chemicals in our bodies to be happy, dose, D-O-S-E, dopamine, oxytocin, serotonin, endorphins, is massage therapy. One session of massage therapy takes the levels of cortisol, the stress hormone, down by 31%, and the levels of all of these happy chemicals in our bodies will go up by 30% as well, just by one session of massage therapy. So practicing new habits, new habit formation that's when dopamine is getting in full fledged.
Dope.
Learning is dope. Literally.
It's dope.
Dopamine is the chemical involved in habit forming. So how important is dopamine? Dopamine is the chemical of learning something new, of celebrating something new. So how important is this chemical? Oxytocin is the chemical of love and connection. When you are shaking a hand, when you're hugging someone, when you're giving love, when you're kissing your kid and put them to sleep and kiss on the forehead and say, oh, I love you so much, honey. And that contact, that physical, spiritual
goosebumps, if you will.
Yes, the goosebumps, that is oxytocin in full-fledged. Serotonin is the chemical of certainty, significance, and security. Okay? Mm. Certainty. When we are certain of something, we are certain that we're having a beautiful conversation right here, right now, serotonin is happy with us. Oh, it's rolling. It's rocking and rolling right now. Oh, my goodness.
When
we are doing the laughter. When we are doing something of extreme significance, like being here, right now, serotonin is really, really in full fledged as well. And endorphins. Endorphins is the pain reducer. Yes, that's the chemical of reduction of pain and emotional stability. When we are caught, what they call the runner's high, when we are dancing, when there's dancing, when there's physical activity, when we are in a state of calm, endorphins is there. So this is basically the basics of these chemicals in the body that we have, and how do we enhance the usage of them? There you go. Learn something new, dopamine. Shake somebody's hand, oxytocin. Serotonin, do something significant. Walk outside. That is significant. Talk to people that you can have a great conversation with. That is serotonin right there. And endorphins, of course, the runner's high. Get some physical activity in your life. Come on. Get up that seat and physical activity is one of the most important things that we can do for life. starting when we are little kids. It's excellent for brain function. It starts, hey, here we go again, back to brain function, cognitive function, dancing. Dancing is excellent for coordination. What you're doing with your left side, you're doing with the right side as well. When I teach my classes, I do it very, very conscious about this. What we do with the left side, we're going to do with the right side. And a lot of people that right-handers, they will go straight to the right side. Oh, I got this down. And then when they go to the left
moving
side.
Moving to Florida, by the way. I need this in my life.
yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And endorphins is, of course, the mood stabilizer when you want to be in a state of calm. When you want to exercise gratitude for the simplest things we have in life. And when you go into prayer, when you go into meditation, the mood stabilizer right there is endorphins, which is the chemical of. So yeah, I love it. I geek out big time.
The one thing that I know comes right tandem to those, to the DOSE, is self care and self-love.
Absolutely.
What does that look like for you, and how do you, what is your perspective of how important that is to the DOSE?
Yes, absolutely. Self-care is the best care. Nobody takes more care of you, more better care of you than yourself. Yep. And nobody takes worse care of you than yourself. Here we go again.
That is true.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's either one way or the other. There is no happy medium here. And definitely when it comes to us, it's really up to us. How are we going to pick up these tools and use the tools that we so very much need for better, here we go again, better quality of life. The more informed we are about something, the better it is to understand. The great father of medicine, Hippocrates, thousands of years ago, he used to believe that with music, fresh air, rest, good physical activity, and great eating habits, the body will stay in a healthy state. And thousands of years later, he is still not wrong. The more
that's true, because we're still humans.
Yeah, we're still human. And this basic knowledge that this powerful soul from thousands of years ago is like, wow, dude, you were ahead of your time here. And it's like, these are the basics, and it's so simple, and it's absolutely the truth. The more we take good care of ourselves, the less we will be going to the doctor, because self-care starts at home. And how do we avoid doctors? How do we avoid going through a pill that it will give us, I don't know how many bad side effects versus the effect, but that's another story for another day.
pills, I love drugs.
Oh my God. Oh my, definitely.
Mm-hmm. We are in a society where everything you're talking about is a pipe dream. And the reason why is because we can hear, you know, especially being neurodivergent, you can hear all these things. You can try it. And every year you have a, what is it called? A New Year's resolution and blah, blah, blah.
Right.
But being in a world where that's hard because we have different egos and different perspectives, and people are either extrovert or introvert, and it's hard to be yourself. We're in a society where our nation is becoming divided. Mm-hmm. It's becoming back, is going backwards to a 60s or whatever era. We're going backwards. And we're now in a place where a woman can possibly be the difference, considering women have had the most horrendous time as humans on Earth. And we all come from a woman. Mm-hmm. What is your perspective on what a evolutionary process could look like with a woman possibly becoming our next president?
I think that change is a constant. Change is a constant. There's a great inspirational speaker that I follow to this day. He was called Jim Rohn. He was Anthony Robinson's
Jim
teacher.
Rohn. Yes, sir. And I know that very well.
And he used to say, Change does not happen by chance. Change happens by being ourselves. You know, life really gets better when we change. And this is the thing. This is what us as humans need to really understand it and really, really, inhale it a little bit more and embrace it a little bit more. From the moment of conception, people, to the moment of our death, we are changing. This is unavoidable. Change is like sleeping. Change is like eating. You cannot run away from change. You can only run away so far, and still change will keep on following you for the rest of your
boomerang.
Life. Yeah. The boomerang effect right here. So going through these changes that I believe that are so necessary for our society that is in so much turmoil, and is so much confusion, so much uncertainty, so much insecurity. We don't know what is happening. We don't know where we are going. And it's like, what is happening here? It's like I am going back to the 60s or the 50s here with some people, from some of these people's attitude. And I know I'm not going to get down the rabbit hole about politics, but
yeah, I don't either.
I am very...
This is a historical moment.
I'm a fan of change, and I believe that everybody should have a chance for change. And if this lady is the one that is meant to be here, all I pray for is hopefully change is going to be for the better. I don't really follow a lot because I have so many other things that I really pay closer attention to.
Yeah, absolutely.
And here in the state of Florida, it's so divided. It's so confusing. It's like really Florida can be Florida, but yes. And I cannot agree more with a lot of people, but at the same time, there's so many people that are so amazing and good-hearted people. But when it comes to this ideology about certain things, it's like, wow, I am a little confused here, but I am not here to really be judging.
Yeah, whose politics or get on one side. Yeah.
Because yeah. I don't base myself on politics. I don't really judge by whoever you're a fan of. You know what?
Go for it.
Have a great time. But you will never see in any of my social media platforms anything that has to do with any kind of politician, because it's always there's always that it can be a rooting for controversy, for hate, for pointing the finger, for judging. And like, I'm not into that crap. You know, I honestly walk away from that. But I am a big fan of change. And if this woman is willing to bring the change that this nation so very much needs, is more than welcome. It's more than welcome. I welcome change in whatever, you know, in whatever capacity. And the most important thing, in my opinion, is change for the better. Don't be changing and going backwards and putting felons in the White House. Oh my God, did I say that out loud? I mean, come on.
It is what it is. It is not a secret, but if we're talking about me, I'm a military guy. It's just not a secret. You wouldn't put a felon in charge of your kids.
No, never, never.
You wouldn't put a felon in charge of your country. This has nothing to do with white, black. This has everything to do with the morality of how we operate. And if we're operating, am I saying a criminal is a bad thing? Mm-hmm. No. But we're looking at patterns here.
Yeah.
And then we're looking at those patterns play out. And then those patterns equal a felon. I'm not even asking the question because she's a woman. It's really more of, I'm upset that women have had a bad go. It upsets me to the nines.
We've been ostracized.
And I'm sitting up here like, is there a chance for a female to be in charge of the country, and we get a I had an amazingly loving mother, so
I would love to see that.
Be nice, you know.
I will love to see that, definitely, and because she's a woman and she's empowered, smart lady. I consider her very, very, very smart, and it's like a breath of fresh air. to be honest with you. And I think here we go again with changes, and I hope it's for the best. I'm praying tremendously that it's for the best. And then again, I really don't follow, but I hope that it's for the best, because there's been a lot of turmoil. It's been very, very hard to really dive into what is happening to this beautiful nation as a whole. Millions of us here of all ethnicities, all backgrounds. I mean, we are a plethora of world-class, wow, variety. How beautiful is variety?
Harmony. And
harmony,
diversity,
variety, diversity, inclusivity. And these are the things that are being lost more and more. And women's rights. Oh, my God. What is going on with women's rights here? Why is this? I mean, why is still a man deciding on what we're doing with our vaginas? Come on. It's like, dude,
let's keep it real. It's your body. How? You know what I'm saying?
Excuse me, bro. Let me do whatever the hell I want with my body. Everybody has the right. And it's like, and this is the thing. I think of it as like, well, if this was the case for men, I wonder. I just wonder. It's like, no, you're not going to have a vasectomy because you're not. You're supposed to have kids and all of this stuff. It's like, what if I decide that I don't want to have any kids? Is that a bad thing? No, it's not. No, it's not. My sister never had kids. She's just fine. So, and I had kids. So it's about respecting people's boundaries, people's differences, people who what their rooting is in life, what they believe in. It's like, you got to be respectful of that. And when these conversations are healthy conversations, they're worth having. But when it starts with bumping heads and people looking down or looking up too much or whatever the case may be, it's like, okay, it's time for me to turn around and walk away because I am not interested. If I am going to have a conversation about this very delicate situation, let it be a productive one where someone can learn something from. Come on, let's have a civil conversation. And how about we agree to disagree for a change? Disagree to disagree, please. And here we go again. How do you make things better? Prevention. Yeah. How do you avoid a bad situation? Prevention. How do you avoid going to three different doctors because all doctors are treating one organ when your body works as a whole, as a team, not as separate entities? What do you do? Prevention and get informed. Well,
I champion your level of passion because the energy you bring is actually Kamala Harris and more.
Thank you.
So as the wounded healer, I'm going to bring on the game cap, Chicago Bulls shiny, and ask you, and in closing, as a speaker, healer, dancer, massage therapist, and all the modalities of medicine, what lasting impression would you like to have on the listeners regarding love, understanding, healing, and how to feel? And how do you fill your cup every day doing all these things?
I fill my cup of doing all of these things by loving myself more.
Awesome.
Self-love. There's no more powerful unconditional love than self-love. And when self-love is within you, everything else does follow. You don't have to prove yourself to no one that love is in within you, because it emanates. It's right here. And what I can tell the listeners is like, here we go again. Don't let your past define who you are. Don't let your past define your future. Okay. Learn the lessons from whatever it used to be on the back. There's a reason, you know, compare your life with a car. Is the rear view mirror big? No, it's this small and to the sides. Is the front of your car bigger? Yes, because you want to look into what is in front of you with, you want to have sight. You want to have peripheral vision. You want to have front vision. You want to look back. And this is when comparing ourselves a little bit to a car, well, it comes sometimes really handy. It's pretty, pretty practical and simple to understand. The rearview mirror is very small for a reason, because you look for a second or two. Yeah. You don't drive front looking back.
Wow.
Because you won't have a collision. Yes. Awesome. I mean, seriously. So what do you do with all of the heartache, with all of the dark seasons in life, with falling down on your knees, with going down that rabbit hole over and over and over and over, and the darkest seasons of your life? Are you going to learn from them, or are you going to grow from them? I would say grow from it. Learn the lesson and apply the lesson that you learn, and make sure that when you're in really full growth, you're just not going to keep on doing this redundant mistake over and over again. Because the definition of insanity is this: doing the same action and expecting different results. Do yourself a favor, okay? Change your narrative. Confront yourself. Those skeletons are knocking on your door. Open that door to that closet and let them,
face them
out.
Not easy, but face them.
And it's not easy. And it's not easy. You got to get out of your comfort zone. You got to get into a space where it's not going to be nice. But I promise you that when you go to the other side, all you're going to do is look at that rearview mirror and say, I'm good now. I will keep on looking forward to whatever is next forward in my life.
Love that comparison.
And that's my message. Yep.
Well, you are a powerful person.
Thank you.
By no stretch of the imagination is that word said lightly. You have graced our presence. You are more than welcome to co-host, come on the block, chill out, and
thank
come
you
back and talk that Latina spice. Everything, because that's what the world needs to hear. The world needs to hear not what entertains you, what cat's dancing on a piano and all that's cool, but entertainment only goes so far. Your brain's entertaining because it's a trauma response, but you really are needing to hear something that's going to make you dive within. And you took us there. So kudos to you. Thank you for coming onto the show. Thank you for gracing us with your presence there in sunny Florida, where it's country California. Johnny Roops, take us out, sir.
All right. Well, heading down to southern Florida, hopefully during my birthday.
That's right. He's a Florida native, by the way.
And you remember, Ken, like how many times I keep bringing up Florida to you?
All the time. Like, Chicago is a distant memory. That's how much you bring it up.
I mean, I've been thinking about Florida for like the last 14 years, and it's still that goal. I still want to get there, even through, you know, things that seem impossible, through these obstacles or whatever's coming my way. I'm still thinking on that goal of living in Florida.
Yes, so please.
Just don't take a Husky. Don't take a Husky. She's going to put out the information. Don't take a Husky. They might not like it.
Yeah. Oh, guys, thank you very much for tuning in to another episode of the 2400 Block Podcast. We appreciate Blanca for her presence here today, giving us some knowledge, dropping up some knowledge. So, yeah, and Ken also. Thank you very much, Ken, for always providing your insight, man.
I try.
Thank you, Ken, for everything. Thank you for the amazing conversation. I'm so full of joy and gratitude, and it's my honor, truthfully, to be here. Thank you.
No, it's good, because the things you said literally took me to the place I needed to be. Because I know, you know, when you meditate and you do all these things and you're just like, I'm literally doing above average stuff and I'm still getting it. But I realized something is that I'm chosen. And the things that I'm going through are greater because my mission is greater. And I learn that every day through my son, that being his dad is the single most important thing ever as a role in my life. And I've been a truck driver. I've been so many things. It's insane. But nothing matters more than trying to understand how to be the best father I can be. So Toastmasters, Here I come.
Yes, please. Oh my God. I love it. I love it. Thank you.
You know what's so amazing is that Ken is like hearing a personality like Blanca and just hearing what she says. And then you're thinking about maybe applying for whatever she said to you and putting it into your life. I mean, who knows? Tomorrow you just might be thinking, you know, the Blanca I'm mentality.
I'm an opportunist. If there's nuggets, you think I'm going to ignore them? No. She nope. dropped nuggets like, yeah. like we're in McDonald's. Make Blanca nuggets all day long. If you didn't get them, you must not be listening. I don't know what you heard, but she talked about canines and how to love them. Yeah. Don't send them to Florida. Keep them in Alaska. I'm just kidding. But take care of them. But self-care, self-love, and getting the basics for yourself is how we'll be able to evolve, not be in a race. Humans are not in a race anymore. We were in a race when we started. But this is a civilization, and we're not being civil. So we need to evolve. So these conversations need to be had every day.
Wow, Ken just evolved into the letter K. Now you're back. Okay. I was wondering what happened to you.
They always say the devil. You know what? I don't even get into that. If it try to take me out, I'm here. I'm going to keep on standing because I don't know how to give up. So
absolutely. Absolutely. Amen to that.
Oh, that was wonderful.
Yeah.
That was wonderful. So grateful to have both of you here tonight. It's been a while since we've done a podcast from, you know, me and Ken. Last time he did a podcast, he was interviewing me.
Yeah.
I never had a podcast interview on myself. That was like one of the most nervous sessions ever.
The reflection is great because the things that we struggle with in our darkness of ourselves, we're really not struggling in the darkness of ourselves. So being able to speak about it takes this perceived darkness away because someone is mirroring, like she said, mirroring the same thing, waiting. We all live our lives as a lesson to others, really. If you really want to break it down, we come on this place with nothing, no place, no time into a place. We're kids, everything's amazing. Then we get inundated with adulting, and we forget who we were. Mm-hmm. If we get to this place of diving within and having these conversations, what do we need to be in the dark for? This is a very lit world of opportunity and endless possibilities, but we keep ourselves shunned to the cookie sheet.
Yeah.
And the cookie sheet is not serving anybody. It's not necessarily harming anybody, but we're not evolving, period. We keep going back into the 50s, the 60s, the 1800s. Why? Mm-hmm. Why when we have a wounded healer showing us exactly what we should be doing, which is being woke, opening up, getting tired of being tired, but really doing something to change. And that was the biggest thing that we're taking here is change only happens is if you're willing to want to. And we're in a duality, so people die, people go, and it's sad, but it's still all part of the evolutionary process. Mm-hmm. Someone will die, but someone will take the baton. Mm-hmm. Someone will live, and someone will finally get it before they die. But it's all a part of being willing to want to change. So
absolutely.
We're here every day, people.
All right. So good night, everyone. It's been a while. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so
much. Don't forget to tune in, subscribe, and Blanca, you have a podcast too.
Oh yeah. Go ahead, plug away.
Plug away, please.
Absolutely, absolutely. You can find my information in www.woundedhealer.us, and you can get all the information that you need from me there. I have a channel in YouTube that is called Wounded Healer Voices. I have done only one podcast there because I've been guest podcasting with people from all over the planet. I've been invited to be in podcasts and I've been really, really occupied with that. And what an honor and a joy it is to be able to spread the word and spread the knowledge and spread the love around with people from all over the world, Spanish and English. This is the advantages of knowing more than one language. You can say it in Spanish. You can say it in English.
True.
Who knows what's coming next? Maybe Italian. So it's all more than welcome to me. But yes, I have a channel in YouTube that is Wounded healer voices, and you will see much more action there. You can see me in all social media platforms as well. And I do a lot of lives, and I am always into giving something of value to as many people as possible.
Thanks for checking out this episode of 2400 Block Podcast. Don't forget to follow and subscribe.